Right now, staying connected is more important than ever, and fast, reliable internet from Xfinity can help. We'll ship you a free self-install kit to make setup quick, safe, and easy. Find great offers and value today at Xfinity.com. Restrictions apply.
Twilight fades through blistered Avalon. The sky's cruel torch on aching Autobahn. Into the uncertain divine.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of Old Men Yell at Cloud. I am Christopher, and I am here joined by Patrick and Jim.
There is bird shit all over my truck.
That's the color of spring.
Why did they put it all over your truck?
They have been targeting me.
Oh, okay. Why?
The birds from ISIS have been targeting me.
Is okay.
Yeah, said the band, right? ISIS.
Yeah, the ISIS birds.
I loved their stage show. It was really cool, and they brought out all the birds.
Yeah, I always had this this funny skit I wanted to do that maybe I only think is funny, but I just imagine an auditorium where, you know, like one of the Apple like reveals or something like that, and like and somebody walks on the stage and just like, ladies and gentlemen, pigeons, and the curtains open and just pigeons come flying out everywhere.
That's it.
Yeah,
have you caught that sketch show, I Think You Should Leave Now?
No,
I made you watch a sketch from it though, right?
Did you?
I think so. The one with the. Oh, did that ever happen to you?
That Tom and Eric were both talking about that yesterday.
Yeah, no, it's definitely up both of your alleys. But there was a bit in there. The auditorium reminded me there was like a baby pageant where like they were trying to decide on the best baby. It was like a beauty pageant style type thing where there was like a full huge crowd. And for some reason, one of the kids, like one of the babies, was hated by everyone. And whenever they showed him or said his name, people in the audience were like, "I hope you die, you piece of shit."
How do you even rate babies? They all look and are basically
that's
the
right.
same.
That's
they,
right.
They all look the goddamn same.
That's the joke.
This is the same show where they were eating the receipts.
Yes.
Okay. All right. I remember now.
Yeah, they were eating the receipts to prove that one of them didn't wipe well enough after the bathroom.
Right. Okay. See, I didn't realize that was a well-known fact. I thought that was just like me being a sociopath or something. Like, oh, all babies are all the same.
No, they're all the same.
Okay, good. I'm glad we're all on the same page.
Spoken like three non-parents.
Yep.
All right. Today we're going to be talking about Adore, which is the fourth studio album by the Smashing Pumpkins, released in June 1998 by Virgin Records. After the multi-platinum success of Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness and a subsequent year-long world tour, follow-up Adore was considered one of the most anticipated albums of 1998 by MTV. Recording the album proved to be a challenge as the band members struggled with lingering interpersonal problems and musical uncertainty in the wake of three increasingly successful rock albums and the departure of drummer Jimmy Chamberlain. Frontman Billy Corgan would later characterize Adore as a band falling apart. Corgan has also mentioned the fact that he was going through a divorce while recording the album. And something that doesn't mention here as well is that his mother passed away between the two albums, which also had a pretty profound effect on the songwriting process. The result was a much more subdued and electronica-tinged sound that Greg Kot of Rolling Stone magazine called a complete break with the past. The album divided the fan base and sold only a fraction of the previous two albums. However, the album was well-received by critics and became the third straight Pumpkins album to be nominated for the Grammy Award for Best Alternative Music Performance, and has gained a cult following. A remastered and expanded version of the album was released on CD and vinyl in September 2014 as part of the band's project to reissue their back catalog, and that is what we listen to tonight.
Now, when you talk about the personal problems within the band, is it just Billy Corgan being an asshole, or is there other things going on?
So, according to Corgan, and so, I mean, obviously take it with a grain of salt.
That should be a podcast.
According to Corgan. Just him doing, like, all these, like, Andy Rooney-style, like, takes.
Oh, God. It hurts when I get up in the morning because all I eat is milk and carrots. Why is the sandwich on a croissant? That's a breakfast pastry. It's not for lunch. Actually, this is pretty delicious. I'll eat the fruity sandwich. Thank you.
So, apparently one of the friction in the band was always there. They always kind of didn't like each other, and Corgan is obviously an egomaniac. But they still managed to kind of get things through for the sake of business, and they kind of had some, you know, gentleman agreement type things, like where Iha would have some input on songs and would do lead vocals here and there. Iha took exception to the fact that on Melancholy, he only had one writing credit. I believe one solo writing credit, and Billy tucked the song at it was track 14 of disc one.
Yeah, it was the very end of disc one. What's it called? Something ground.
Yeah,
take me down. There we go.
Take me down. Take me down. Yeah. So based on that sequencing, like he basically shut himself off and no longer tried to write for the Pumpkins or do anything like that.
Right.
So he was basically distant for the whole process of recording Adore. He was in the studio with them, and then when they relocated to Los Angeles, Corgan wanted them to all like live and record in a rented house together, and Iha not only did not live there, but basically stopped showing up at a certain point. So yeah, it was a little fractured, and it's not really talked about too much, but Darcy was starting to get into pretty heavy drug use at this point. To the point where she actually quit before Machina came out, or even before they started recording Machina, even though she's the credited bass player on it.
And you know, like, Billy's whole attitude towards that was like, very insensitive and shitty. So you know that the whole time he was just verbally abusing Darcy.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Darcy, you fucking smackhead!
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I don't know where this Corgan voice is coming from, but I'm kind of into it.
Yeah, I mean, it's just sort of like it's you got to have the Chicago slant because he's a Chai boy.
Oh yeah, he is.
Yeah, big time. I remember seeing actually. It was when the Cubs were in the World Series. They didn't win. It was like 2003 or something like that. But he was in the audience, and they got him to sing
Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Yeah.
Take me out to the ball game.
No, you just gotta honk
root,
your nose.
Root for the Cubbies.
The world is a vampire.
The Cubbies.
Oh, hi, Billy. We called them the Cubbies.
The Cubbies.
God, he is tapped.
Oh, yeah, he is. There is one thing that you cannot say about Billy Corgan, and that is he is not an interesting individual.
Oh, no, for sure.
Oh, definitely not. He always has something up his sleeve.
Yeah, and he's unfortunately had some pretty hot takes recently that are pretty appalling.
I mean, I'd say for the... I mean, this is kind of generalizing, but I'd say for the most part, famous people and, like, CEOs of company are generally sociopaths. So, I mean...
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I think that is a key part of why he was and continues to be pretty successful.
Yeah.
All right, let's get going on this. Patrick, what was your favorite song?
Ooh, so my favorite song was Daphne Descends. I really, I dug this track a lot. The chord progression reminded me a lot of In the Arms of Sleep, actually. It kind of had, like, similar, just like a similar progression to it. It's very, very shoegazy with the pushed back drums. This record was, you know, kind of marketed as being the techno album. But, like, in reality, it's more shoegazy than anything else, like in essence.
Yeah, and I think more than techno, it just really was more of an extension of the second disc of Melancholy. It didn't go full techno. It had some acoustic elements. It really was not that dissimilar from disc two of Melancholy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I thought that was a super strong track. There are a couple other songs on the record that I think were almost as good, but very close to being favorites as well. But that one in particular, I'd probably go with.
Name one. Throw it on the spot.
Fuck. Hold on. I have the name here. There's Apples and Oranges I really liked. And then For Martha, too. I really
like
that one. And Shame had, like, you know, very, very Curie type guitars, but...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Apples and Oranges got me thinking because I had a conversation with Rob Fusco from the drummer from Barry Lamar, my old band, And he is a huge Smashing Pumpkins fan and was going to be a guest on this episode until he couldn't at the last second and what have you. Yeah. And I was telling him that I think the Pumpkins' career trajectory could have been entirely different if they didn't lead off with Ava Adore as a single and they led off with Apples and Oranges or Perfect as opposed to Ava Adore, because that gave people sort of too much of an idea that the Pumpkins were weird and gothy and still having the distorted guitars and stuff, and that really wasn't the case.
Yeah, I think we're, like Ava Adore, I remember when that single came out, and just the first thing I noticed about the song was the drums and how electronic they sound.
Yeah.
And it felt like, okay, this is the mission statement, this is going to be the techno album, blah, blah,
yeah.
blah. And I ignored the album for years as a result, just because, I mean, not that I have anything against electronics, but, like, I think when I was younger, I was probably more into, like, guitar-driven rock.
Yeah, yeah.
Just kind of, like, leery about...
Like Dream Theater.
Jim, what was your favorite song?
Actually, I wanted to make a comment on you were talking about Daphne Sends, how it reminds you of songs. Actually, the drum part in that song, fucking, I love the snare sound, but as I was kind of zoning in on the snare drum sound of that song, I started thinking, like, this reminds me of something, and then it was like, the drum part of that song reminds me of fucking One Headlight by the Wallflowers.
Yeah, it's got that same galloping,
it's got that 90s,
sort of, yeah.
like... Same year. Yeah.
Yeah, that the snare drum on that song has a definite snap to it.
Oh, for
I
sure.
will give it.
Yeah.
That.
Yeah. My favorite song is going to be Perfect. And the reason that it's going to be my favorite song is I am not familiar with this album really at all. I mean, I knew Ava Adore, and obviously Perfect came on, and I knew that. And I think I actually had heard Daphne Descends before. And then, you know, obviously the songs that they played when we saw them a few months ago. But yeah, no, Perfect's got that kind of like, it's got like a really springtime kind of vibe. Like, you know, you got the windows down, you're fucking cruising along. It's just kind of,
yeah, it's kind of got that like pseudo jungle beat going on with it. That's got, you know, nice energy to it.
Yeah. The music video for it was, if I remember correctly, like a straight up sequel to the 1979 video, capturing it on sort of the same mood. So
yeah,
that makes sense.
Yeah. I could tie those.
What about you, Buckaroo?
Together.
Oh, hey. So for me, it's pretty close. There are a few that are up there for me. Like For Martha is up there for me. Daphne Descends is up there for me. But I'm going to go with Crestfallen. Because I think that's a really great example of simple Billy Corgan songwriting done right. Because he usually has a tendency to kind of overdo things, especially on this record. Like, he's fucking swinging for the fences. And I just thought that Crestfallen is a great example of just chords and melody working out, and the lyrics aren't too clunky on it. And, yeah, it's a great song. I come back to it time and time again. Close second is Shame.
Yeah, I like Shame a lot too.
I like the soundscape in Shame.
Yeah,
really nice. Like
the pitchiness of everything, just kind of coming in and out of tune.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, the super wavery guitar is very, very nice.
All right, least favorite.
Least favorite. Man, I had a tough time kind of picking that. I was gonna go with Annie Dog. The vocals weren't terribly engaging on it. You just kind of sounded bored. The piano stuff was fine, and like the arrangement was okay. But yeah, if I had to pick one that I would like most likely skip, it would be that one.
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat on that, especially vocally, because it just sounds like he's out of steam. Like, it sounds like it's the last song, and he just needs to finish it, and for some reason, he really needs to include it. Yeah, Jim, how about you?
Actually, my least favorite, and it's strictly that, is my least favorite. I'm gonna go with Crestfallen, actually.
Ooh.
And the reason was, is I don't know, some of the programming there just felt kind of Casio-esque, I feel.
Yeah.
And it just kind of turned me off. And then there was one point where Billy really, like, belted out his kind of buzzsaw vocals that kind of a little irritating. But other than that, yeah. I mean, this album was kind of hard for me to digest on the fly like we did. Like, I'm sure if I gave this a few more listens and kind of really pulled out a lot of the
there's a lot of tracks.
Nuances and stuff.
There's a lot of tracks. It's too long. Yeah. That's one thing I will definitely say about this album. It is certainly too long. But yeah, it is certainly a grower. It's one that the first time I listened to it, I think I maybe like picked out two songs and could tell you anything about them afterwards. But now it's just like every single song. Like it's for me personally, it's really hard to pick a least favorite because there's a few songs on it that I think are great, and then there's a lot that I think are really good.
Mm-hmm.
So they kind of all fall into that category for me. I'm gonna, in the sake of being interesting, I would pick Annie Dog, but The Tale of Dusty and Pistol Pete, I think would be up there for me too. Solid pop song, some more of the kind of like country tinged Corgan, which is kind of like a nice little treat to get. But yeah, it just at that point in the album, like that and Annie Dog just felt like kind of a lull on a very long album.
Yeah, I could see that. I couldn't remember much about that song other than the drum production I was kind of striking to me. They were like super bone dry and sounded pretty cool with the acoustics. But yeah, other than that, it wasn't terribly noteworthy. One thing I'll say about like least favorites on this album is that I'm really happy that there isn't like a fucking quote unquote creepy Billy Corgan song. Like I feel like on every record there's like, really not on Gish, but like on Siamese Dream there's like Sweet Sweet. And then, like, on Melancholy, there's, like, a ton of these fucking, like, they only come out at night type songs. Where it's, like, they just creep me the fuck out. And, like, and they're just weird. And, like, it just sounds like they're self-indulgent, but also, like, I don't know. Like,
you could,
I don't know if these sounds are supposed to be ironic or
it's
not.
It's funny that you mentioned that. Do you know the song I that they did that was on the Lost Highway soundtrack?
Yeah. Was that like on Pisces Iscariot 2 or something?
No, it was after that.
Yes. Dun, yeah, dun, it was on dun, the dun, Greatest Hits.
Yeah. That was supposed to be on Adore, and Corgan had written Tear for the Lost Highway soundtrack, and David Lynch heard it, and he's like, do you have anything else? And they gave him I instead, which I think would have filled that role for you had it stayed on the album.
Oh, good. Yeah, now I do remember that song.
I can picture,
I have this song. It's called I.
That's excellent, Billy. Can I have it to use in my feature film, Lost Highway?
Only if you are nice to my cats.
I won't smoke near them.
No, you have to say hi. Say hi, Mr. Cardamom.
I know Laura Dern. Do you know Laura Dern? She's in many films, including Jurassic Park.
I don't like that new Star Wars movie.
I can picture Billy Corgan like hiding up in a tree, like watching you like in your bedroom at night for sure. Just craning his neck.
Holding his son, Augustus Jupiter.
All right, Augustus.
He turned into David Lynch. All right, I'm giving up on that thread. Yeah, so what's your MVP moment? We're fucking cruising right along.
Yeah. Da, 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 da.
My MVP moment was actually going to be just the piano lines in general in For Martha, but like particularly the intro. I think it's some of the most elegant piano stuff I've heard Corgan play. You know, I made a mention when we were listening to this, I really appreciated the presence of, like, real acoustic grand piano versus, like,
yeah.
On Melancholy, he was using, like, this sort of, like, Kurzweil, very 90s piano
yeah.
patch. But
yeah, it's like the same keyboard that the dude from Singled Out used, the guy that was in the DJ booth.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. And, like, it kind of made it sound corny and almost like, oh, like, it reminded me of being, like, a, you know, 16-year-old and writing my first pretty song or something yeah. like that. But, like, this song in particular was, yeah, just sounded, like, very mature and like, the Mac Cameron drums were like, a nice touch. It just kind of reminded me of, like Blonde in the Bleachers, Joni Mitchell-type stuff. And, yeah, I mean, it was, like, an 8.5-minute song, but, you know, for the most part, the piano stuff kept me pretty engaged.
Yeah, I'm just going to hop in and agree with that because that was mine too, and there's not a second place for me to pick for MVP moment. That piano part is just fucking amazing.
It really is.
I think it's one of the best little pieces of music that Billy has gifted the world. And yeah, it's just all the more touching just knowing that it's about like his mother and her passing away and him like being with her as she was passing away. And it's just like a really kind of touching moment for him, which is pretty rare. Jim, how's about you?
I'm going to piggyback off of you guys. This isn't my MVP, but I just want to make it an honorable mention. I do love the kind of, oh, I wouldn't say it's over-compressed, but it's heavily compressed, the piano on Blank Page. I really dug that. But my actual MVP moment is going to be the drums in Annie Day. I actually felt like that was one of the more natural kind of drum performances / sounding performances on the record. Upon our face we leave no trace, but in a
stunning mercury age, she holds the blood. Yeah, I did like I did like the drum production on that song. I remember that. For first time listening to this a few years back, I wasn't anticipating so many acoustic songs on a record that was billed as a, you know, techno record. But that is really misleading and definitely not what you get. It's quite a bit of these nice acoustic moments.
It's not an acoustic album. It's not a techno album. It's a weird Smashing Pumpkins album, I think is really the best way to describe it.
It's a dark horse, I think.
Oh, certainly. Yeah, and I think that's what draws me to it is I'm a fucking sucker for these albums that people hate.
Right.
Do people hate this album?
It's generally regarded as the turning point for the Pumpkins. So yeah. Most fans are fans of them through Melancholy and then kind of fall off at that point.
Yeah.
Adore definitely made a significant dent in their fan base. They played The Garden on the tour for Melancholy, and they played The Orpheum for the tour for Adore.
I got you.
For example, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was a pretty significant drop. Yeah, and it sold a fraction of what like Melancholy and the others had sold. So yeah, it was a pretty big blow for them in terms of career. And you know, obviously, there's a whole multitude of reasons for that with Jimmy Chamberlain and all sorts of other things. But this album,
well, their keyboardist passed away too, died of an overdose or something.
Yeah,
right?
Jonathan Melvoin. Yeah, because he was with Chamberlain when it happened, so that's why they fired Chamberlain. What would you say is your MVP moment?
I already did that.
Yeah, we already did that, Chris.
Yes, you did. What's your comparable album?
Oh, shit.
Man, I have a feeling that, like, you guys probably also thought this went well, but, I mean, first thing I thought of was REM's Up.
yeah.
Just, I mean, that one's, like, pretty obvious just because, A, 1998, they lost a crucial member, their drummer, and, you know, had to work with a bunch of session musicians. It sort of has...
Joey Wanger appears on both.
Yeah, exactly. When I looked at that, I was like, oh, I mean, this is just way too stupid obvious to me. And I think if I weren't going to go with that one, I would go with My Bloody Valentine's MBV.
Interesting.
Yeah, just because of the kind of general production and sound and like, yeah, there was... I don't want to like give this album too much credit and compare it to Loveless, but like MBV has like a lot of these sort of pushed back electronic-y drums, but also like introduces a lot more acoustic-y type stuff. Sonically, kind of some stuff reminded me of that.
Nice.
I'm going to be boring because I will admit I didn't really think about this. Kind of had a brain fart. But, when you brought up the fact that kind of the second half of Melancholy is along the same lines of this, I totally agree with that. So I'm gonna use that as my pop out.
All right.
Only disc two.
Yeah, only disc two.
I'm going to go back to the year 1997 and go for another album from a band after losing a crucial member. And I'm going to say Depeche Mode's Ultra, which I'm pretty sure I've referenced before on this show.
I think this is the third time you've referenced that record.
Quite possibly. We definitely need to do that album at some point because I fucking love Ultra. It's another Dark Horse album.
Yeah, that one's pretty good.
But yeah, same thing. Losing a crucial member, tinkering with the sound a bit, and just kind of trying to feel what's going on. And it's a crucial album in the sense that it's the next one before the one after. And just kind of like continuing and figuring out what the fuck to do next. So yeah, that's what I would pick. All right, let's we can fucking put a bow on this shit already. Jesus, this is brisk.
Yeah, for sure.
What's your rating?
All right. Well, I'm going to do it nice and slow so we can eat up some time. I'm going to give it a 7. And it's definitely not my favorite Pumpkins album. I will say, to its credit, there aren't any like really obnoxious moments like you get on like Siamese Dream and like especially on Melancholy. It kind of stays like pretty consistent throughout. The weak moments are really just boring, if anything, not obnoxious. I think vinyl really suited this album very well. There's some points like on like the more shoegazy tracks where like just the sort of warmth of the vinyl format like kind of, you know, warmed the pitch a bit and like did some cool things, very pleasing. Now I was surprised that it would be so nice to listen to on vinyl, but it was. I'm going to give it a 7. It could climb up if I give it more listens, but that's what I'm going to give it for now.
Jim, how's about you?
I am also going to give it a 7. As I mentioned before, this is kind of my first listen of this other than the two I mentioned. But I do, other than it being a little bit too long, I think maybe some songs could be cut off on the chopping block, but overall, I thought it was a sonically interesting album. I think the arrangements were good. You know, I agree with Patrick. There was nothing really obnoxious on it where I was like, oh, yeah. But, 7.
Cool. I'm going to give it a 9. It's my favorite Smashing Pumpkins album, which is not a surprise, as I keep saying I'm into Dark Horse albums. I like primarily Siamese Dream through Machina. I like all those albums quite a bit. And this is the one that, if I'm going to sit down and listen to an album by Smashing Pumpkins, it's probably going to be Adore, which I understand is not the norm for people out there, but I also listen to REM's Up before any of their other albums, too. Right. My taste is a little different. I agree with you, Patrick, that the vinyl format really suited this, but I think it worked out that way for time. Having to stop every 4 songs to flip the vinyl and just take that mental break, I think really made the pacing significantly better for especially such a long album.
It kind of gave the chunk of songs a little more gravitas, too. It's a nice experience.
Exactly. With that in mind, again, it's I always look at Kid A or like The Fragile or something like that, the tens for me, and this isn't a 10, but it's really fucking high. I don't think the Smashing Pumpkins have anything below an 8 for me, so this is a 9. And that cumulatively gives us a 7.6, which I think is probably a pretty fair score for this album in general.
I would agree. Yeah, absolutely. Definitely better than it. Definitely underrated. Definitely better than it. Got credit for.
Yeah, for sure. Patrick, you got any stuff you want to plug? This is going out on June 1st.
June 1st, all right. Well, Smell's got a show with you two assholes playing with us, too.
Heck yeah.
That's happening at Uncharted in Lowell, over on Market Street in Lowell on June 22nd. We're playing with Knockover City, Crow Feeder, and Ari Slang.
That reminds me, I got to book the barn.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. We gotta practice.
Yeah, I'm very excited for the show. I like Uncharted a lot, and I've never played there, so I'm excited to do that.
Yeah, it's a super fucking fun venue. Great crowd, great people.
Good space.
Good space.
Yeah, it's cool. It's basically, there's no like stage there. It's basically like an art space that has a PA.
Okay. So yeah, I was getting a little claustrophobic at Plow and Stars.
Oh, no. It's not like that. It's not like that. Okay. And I hear they have really good pizza there, but I haven't eaten it because I always go to Wings right across the street, Wings Over.
I fucking love Wings Over.
Fucking, dude, then you and I can go before the show and just eat like a couple of fucking animals.
Let's do it.
That sounds fucking great.
Jim, you got anything?
I'm playing a show at Uncharted with Patrick and Christopher on June 22nd. I've been working on the drums for Todd from Down City Armory. His new album is going to be coming out someday, and I'm doing drums for it. So,
exciting.
Yeah, I saw him yesterday. Well, not yesterday, as in...
Yesterday, you know, as of this recording.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Cool.
We did some talking about some things. But other than that, so I've been staring at your shirt all day trying to figure out what it's from, and I know I've seen that dog before, and I've seen that shirt, and I've probably asked you the same question. What is that from?
I can't think of the name of the movie off the top of my head. It starts with a C. It's a Disney movie about the kid with the guitar goes to the underworld.
Oh, yes. Yeah, I saw that.
Coco,
yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. I didn't. I was like, I watched that on the way home from Japan with Emily, and we both almost like cried.
Yeah, it's a sad movie. It's a great movie. And we were going through Epcot, and I went into like the Mayan pyramid that they have there, and this was for sale there, and this shirt is fucking awesome. So for those playing at home, it's just a kind of slightly sloppy drawn version of Dante the dog from Coco.
I thought it was one of the two stupid dogs for a second, but definitely not.
I love two stupid dogs.
Do you remember two stupid dogs?
I've only seen one episode ever of it, and they were leading a guy who had like... He had like his like he had like his pupils dilated so he couldn't see for a while.
Yeah.
And they were leading him around the city, and they were doing it in like the most dangerous way possible. And kept saying like, shortcuts this way.
Oh, I do remember that episode. This way's
they were doing their best. And then the big
one would always barf up like a full ear of corn. Yeah. It would have butter on it.
Have you ever seen the real life Lady and the Tramp video?
I don't think so.
Yep.
Yeah, the sound, I remember.
And you just see this dog vomit like an entire portion of unchewed spaghetti. Very good.
The sound is priceless.
I don't really have anything going on at the moment, but be sure to check out the other shows on the Zero Science Network.
Oh yeah,
your Jukebox Zeros, your Nickelback, and all your favorites. And if you have the time, give us a review. Give us some 5 stars on iTunes so people can discover us.
Or 1 star. I want to see some hate mail.
Yeah, if you give us 1 star, that's fine. But give us a really, really good description. Not saying like positive, be funny about it. Like, have a sense of humor. I want to be entertained if you're going to give us 1 star. That's all.
I got called a liberal beta boy today on Facebook.
Did
Pretty
you?
Proud.
That, nice. That, yeah, that makes sense, you cuck.
Yeah, very true. I mean, I made fun of a cop, so of course I'm a beta boy.
I don't think I've heard that one. What's a beta boy?
Oh, like big, like alpha male beta boy.
Oh, gotcha.
I really. You could have given me like 10 guesses as to why you were called that, but making fun of a cop is not one of what I would have guessed.
I mean, he's asking for.
The thin blue line. All right.
I'm actually surprised that Patrick doesn't get more shit than he does for the things he posts on fucking Facebook.
Well, I think the FBI is logging it. They're planning their attack.
I don't even post on Facebook anymore. I just observe. I just observe the insanity.
At this juncture, I just share memes.
Yeah.
Because it's like...
Well, that's why I fucking love Rick's page.
Yeah, well, basically what I do is I'm sort of like I'm a Rick filter for my friends and family who aren't friends with Rick on Facebook. I'm there for them.
Yeah, okay.
I'm providing a filtration service for them.
You're boosting his signals, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. That's all we can really do is boost Rick's signals. All right, cool. I think that about does it for us for this particular installment. I am Christopher.
I'm Patrick.
I'm Jim. And we'll see you in hell.
Good night.
Vampire!
Zero Science. Lils and Patrick are two local musicians from the New England area whose minimal accomplishments have left them thoroughly unqualified to judge bands and artists who have been more successful than they ever could be. And yet, their passion for bad music persists on Jukebox Zeros, the podcast that takes a retrospective look at the worst albums of all time. From The Shags to Attila, from Cyberpunk to Scream, if there's a band that has an album they're ashamed of, Lils and Patrick will be there. Share